This show is part of the RetroZap.com podcast network.
This is Podcast Stardust.
This station is now the ultimate power in the universe.
With Dennis Keithley and Jay Krebs.
Your behavior is continually unexpected.
The galaxy source for Star Wars news, reviews, and discussion.
Now witness the firepower of this fully armed and operational battle station.
Hello, I'm Dennis Keithley.
And I'm Jay Krebs.
And welcome to another fully armed and operational edition of Podcast Stardust, the galaxy's source for Star Wars news, reviews, and discussions. And before we get to this week's review of The Mandalorian, Jay, where can we be found around the internet?
We are on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram at Podcast Stardust. And we can be reached by email at podcaststardust@retrozap.com.
So if you've been listening to us for a while now, you know the drill. This is a full spoiler review of Chapter 3, The Mandalorian. If you have not seen it, just like the previous two chapters, you really need to see it before you listen to any recaps. And we'd love to get you to join the discussion. So thanks for the download, but please go watch it first. And otherwise, if you don't care and you want to hang out, well, then welcome to the discussion. But with that out of the way, this episode was written by Jon Favreau, as with all the others, and directed by Deborah Chow. Jay, could you give us the summary?
The Mandalorian returns to the client with the child, and despite having second thoughts, turns over the bounty in return for a Kamtano of Beskar. With his payment in hand, the Mandalorian returns to the Mandalorian covert, and after a brief challenge to his honor and bravery by another Mandalorian, the armorer settles the matter and crafts new armor for him. Afterwards, the Mandalorian pays a visit to Greef Karga, who is basking in the Mandalorian's success, where the other bounty hunters have failed. Karga refuses to provide any answers as to the child's fate, as that is against the code of the guild. Even though he acquired a new bounty, the Mandalorian has second thoughts and infiltrates the client's compound, fights through a dozen stormtroopers, and rescues the child. On the way back to his ship, the Mandalorian is ambushed by Greef Karga and the guild, but the Mandalorian covert comes to his rescue, which allows the Mandalorian to make his escape with the child.
All right, so there you go. That's the summary of the episode. Very, very basic summary of the episode. There's a lot going on here. But Jay, overall, what's your impression of this one?
W-O-W, all exclamation points at the end.
Yeah.
Wow. I mean, we're getting to know the Mandalorian and a little bit more of his whole psyche. Mm-hmm. We're getting to see more of the Mandalorian culture in terms of how they view each other, how they treat each other, what their code is. We also get a lot of the child in this one in terms of just the little ways that it reacts to the things going on around it without saying a word. Mm-hmm. And we get more of a relationship between the Mandalorian and the child as well.
Yeah. What did you think he was going to turn the child over at all?
You know what? I wasn't sure. I figured he probably would because that was just his way as a bounty hunter. But I kind of figured he probably would go back and try to get him.
I knew one of two things was going to happen. He was either going to turn the child over or refuse to turn the child over, and if he turned the child over, he was going to go back and get him. And I love this episode. It was great. And so this is going to sound like a complaint, but it really isn't. I felt like the plot was fairly predictable for the majority of the episode, but that being said, it was doubling and tripling down on the Star Wars Western theme that we've had going on with mm-hmm. the Mandalorian here. And so, and it delivered beautifully on all of that. Oh, yeah. And like you said, the Mandalorian culture part was a real highlight here. So let's just kind of tackle some of the elements here. And one of the things that you brought up is this whole notion of the rules of the Bounty Hunters Guild. And when the Mandalorian delivers the child, or Baby Yoda, whatever you want to call it, to the client, he gets paid, and you did a good job. It's a Kamtano of Beskar, the Kamtano being the ice cream maker looking thing that we saw in Empire Strikes Back. After he's paid, the Mandalorian asks, so what are you going to do with it? The client, you know, Werner Herzog's character, says, you know, oh, that's an interesting question that you would ask, because you've taken a commission and you've been paid. And, you know, that's, you know, our understanding is that, you know, you don't get to ask, you don't get to know. And then when he returns to Greef Karga later and he tells him that he wants his job, he wants his next job. Then he asks Greef Karga, you know, what are they going to do with this child? And Greef Karga says, you know, that in shorthand, you know, you don't get to know. That's part of our rules that we, you know, no questions asked. We do the job, you get paid. And that's not very satisfactory to him. So it's kind of an interesting thing. You know, back in Legends, there was a Bounty Hunters Guild. And as we discussed earlier in a review of the first chapter, there was a Bounty Hunters Guild that was established in the Aftermath novels that Dengar helped put together. And so this may be the descendant or that same guild, I'm not sure. Mm-hmm. But there's still a certain amount of lawlessness between Bounty Hunters. I mean, they were all shooting at each other over the previous two episodes. But now they have this rule that they can't ask about the bounty. And then when the Mandalorian tried to make off with the child, they all went after him.
Mm-hmm. Now, let's back up just a little bit here. There's a couple things. So the first thing, when I saw this Camtano, the ice cream maker, of course, you know, the first thing I thought of was Wilro Hood, as you mentioned, from The Empire Strikes Back. So is a Camtano just basically like your average portable safe kind of thing, or is this the Camtano from The Empire Strikes Back that explains why he was running with it, because the Beskar was so valuable?
My understanding is the Camtano that was The Empire Strikes Back had rebel secrets contained inside. This was a Camtano, not the Camtano, and so it is just a secure way of carrying around something. And in this case, it happened to be the Beskar.
Gotcha. Well, can I just say how much I love the fact that an ice cream maker that was just sort of like a random prop is now Star Wars canon?
Oh, yeah.
I just think that's so cool. So, all right. So when he's walking in after he gets off the Razor Crest with the child, Baby Yoda, did you get the feeling that, okay, he really should cover this bassinet? You know, like, close the darn bassinet. Here's Baby Yoda looking around at all these things going on around him. And he's also got it behind him. Because all I could think of was how easy it would be in that particular setting for somebody to just take it out if they wanted to take out the child. Because there it is, and it's behind him, so it's not like it's in front of him and he's watching it. That bothered me.
Yeah, I hear you. What I've come to notice, and this kind of plays into something else that I want to talk about as well, is that there are things in this show that are sacrificed for the sake of brevity and the sake of the story, and that being one of them. And on the one hand, I could see the Mandalorian walking through this town and kind of in this environment, he's got the child at this point. He's fought off bounty hunters and he's there making the delivery. I don't know that it's really a legit move for someone to try and steal the bounty out from under him, one of his competitors at this point. Because when he walks into the cantina and he's talking to Greef Karga, you know, Greef is like, you know, they hate you, Mando. You succeeded where they all failed. Only you could deliver. And so, you know, it was just kind of this notice that in a way it's kind of him walking through, you know, that's right. I got the child. None of you losers did. You know, not that he would ever brag quite like that. But yeah, there's something to what you're saying. And the other thing is, the Mandalorian asks both the client and he asks Greef Karga, how many tracking fobs did you give out? And they both acknowledge that they gave out multiple bounties. And the client said, it was super important. I get this asset. It's of extreme importance. I had to assure delivery. And then Greef Karga, when he gets asked about it, you know, he says all the bounty hunters had them, but not one of them can close a deal. And then it was funny, one of the bounty hunters, you know, delivers the chuta line and turns around there at the bar. That being said, we still don't get a satisfactory answer to why so many of the bounty hunters were trying to kill the child as opposed to bring him back alive. When it was made clear that the child delivered alive was worth more than dead. Exactly. So I kind of feel like maybe this falls into one of those things. Now, that still opens the possibility that there is a competing client out there offering other bounties, because nothing has foreclosed that yet. But at least at the moment, it seemed like they were trying to get around the, this is why all these other bounty hunters were showing up. It's because they'd all be given tracking files by the same people.
Mm-hmm. Do you think that possibly it could be almost a bird in the hand is worth two in the bush kind of thing, that at least if they can kill the child, they'll get something out of it? Maybe they got the same type of mandate, but it just, you know, it was kind of like some would choose to do one thing versus another based on the ease.
That might be possible for, say, like the Trandoshans, but remember what IG-11 said at the end of Chapter 1, which is that the bounty was very specific. It's termination, which was not what the client told the Mandalorian.
Good point, right.
So
it's true.
You know, I don't know if that is, I don't want to use the word sloppy. I just, like I said, I think maybe it's for the sake of creating tension in the episode. That's the way it's been done. Mm-hmm. But regardless, there are these kind of conflicts in there that it may be in there for the sake of adding these type of elements for the show. Not satisfactory to us who are looking to tie everything up in a in-universe realism type of perspective, but there they are.
Right.
So let's talk about the Mandalorians for a little bit, because when I saw this, I thought, you know, Jay is going to love this section of the episode.
And but you he does, right.
Yeah, well, he turns to the armorer with his Kamtano of Beskar and opens it up, and everyone's got helmets, so you can't see facial reactions, but there's a big scene that develops there with multiple Mandalorians, and she's clearly impressed that he brought all this back, and he reports that his armor's lost its integrity, so he kind of has to start over. So she's going to build him a new cuirass, but he ends up getting another pauldron, I think new gauntlets as well, from what I can tell. Then another Mandalorian comes in and calls him a coward and says that he got this from the Empire. He sits at the table with Imperials. The armorer goes on and says that when someone lives the life of Mandalorian, they're both the hunter and the prey. How can someone who chooses this way of life be a coward? There was just so much goodness in that scene.
Yes.
What stood out to you from all that?
Well, you know, as soon as this whole scene started, I just thought, okay, we're going to get some lore here. We're going to get something. And then I heard the voice. Mm-hmm. And I thought, okay, that sounds a lot like Jon Favreau.
Yes.
But then I thought, okay, no, it can't be. But of course, we'll get to that in a minute. However, just the whole idea of the armorer basically putting all of this weight on what Beskar means. All I could think of was, you know, how cool is this? I wonder how the Mandalorian mercs feel about this knowledge coming to basically common knowledge now in the canon, where I feel like a lot of this lore was kind of kept almost sequestered to a certain sort of population of the fandom. You know what I mean? Because there were people that are so heavily laden on Jedi lore or Sith lore. And then there was this whole other segment of kind of the fandom that was focused on Mandalorian culture, and myself being one of those. And I just thought, oh man, this is so awesome. And they did so much in such a small amount of time. I mean, they established the idea of how valuable Beskar is. They established the idea that this is a community. And, you know, just from what the Mandalorian said about, you know, making sure that the foundlings get some of this, the whole idea of honor with his signet, because she said, you know, that the mudhorn should be his signet. And he said, no, I can't accept that. And she said, well, why not? And he said, because I had help from an enemy. And she said, well, why would an enemy help you? And to which he responded, well, they didn't know that they were my enemy at the time. And she respected that.
Yeah.
So, you know, she didn't even question it any further. She said, okay, we're going to find another use for this.
Right.
So, yeah.
And the other thing that was interesting there was that when she's reconciling this accusation that Paz Vizsla, which was the character that Jon Favreau voiced,
which I want to come back to.
Yeah, she says, you know, well, have you ever taken off your helmet? And he says, no. Has anyone ever else taken off your helmet? And he said, no. And so that's new. But I'm thinking back to Rebels and Clone Wars, and the Mandalorians are taking their helmets off all the time. And in addition, we got to see in the trailer for this show, at some point, there is a woman who has her hands on both sides of his helmet. Mm-hmm. Looks like she's about to lift it off his head. And so, you know, I guess we got a preview of an upcoming conflict there. But then there was this challenge that, you know, Paz made with, you know, this coward is being here, which I wondered how much of that was an honest challenge as much as it was maybe Paz just kind of testing him a little bit there by calling him out. You know, and he makes mention that we're scattered and we're in hiding. And our condition is such that only one of us can crawl to the surface at a time, like rat, you know, we're like rats. And, you know, then he levels his accusation of cowardice. Personally, I think maybe a little bit was a test, but then the armorer delivers that lecture about when you've elected the Mandalorian way of life, how can you be a coward? Because you're both the hunter and the prey in this.
Yes, you have no choice, basically, at that point. Well, I think the whole, you know, not removing the helmet thing goes back to more of Legends / EU, because I remember that more being sort of a very special, very significant kind of a cultural thing. And that was, you know, I think maybe in the Clone Wars, it was more for the idea that it was an animated series. And although, you know, obviously a lot of adults watched it, it was geared towards kids. So that was the only way perhaps that they were able to keep characters straight at the time, is to maybe sort of let that little bit of lore slide perhaps. But yeah, I mean, it's the whole idea. And can I just say how much I loved watching her forge all of that armor and the flashbacks in between that, and and the theme of the Mandalorian with it, but yet very distressed. And it was so well interdisposed with, you know, each other. And it just really gave you a feel for that scene. So,
yeah, isn't it interesting, though, the flashbacks? He only has those when the armorer is crafting his armor. And the first time in Chapter 1, it was a pared-down version of the flashback he had this time, where you saw the people running. We assume it's his parents, and then his parents hiding him in a box or a closet or something somewhere. This time, we had the battle droids coming into the picture. And so I'm wondering what's going to happen in like two episodes from now. Next time he's having some piece of armor or something crafted, if we're going to get more of that story there. But they're kind of giving us the backstory in pieces there, just enough to question and to wonder. And I can't help but suspect that we're going to have some major revelation towards the end of this season about his parents and more stuff that happened during that attack. You know, did somebody betray somebody else that allowed the separatists to come in there and attack it? Was this on Mandalore during the siege of Mandalore, or what happened here?
Exactly. And, you know, and that had a very Jyn Erso feel to me as well. Just the way that they put him into some sort of an enclosure, and he's looking up at them, and then it closes, and then the next thing you see is the battle droid instead of Saw Gerrera. You know what I mean? It had that same kind of Rogue One feeling. But let's talk about Paz Vizsla for just a second. So Vizsla, of course, we know pre-Vizsla was also voiced by Jon Favreau in the Clone Wars, and he met a very unfortunate end. So is this is obviously from House Vizsla. And so we don't know anything more about this particular character as of yet, do we?
No, we really don't, you know, because along that same line, you know, Sabine was in Clan Ren of House Vizsla as well. Right. And so the Vizsla name is pretty big, and it's, I think, supposed to be very encompassing. And so I was fascinated by that as well. And I really need to go back and brush up on all the Mandalorian episodes from the Clone Wars and Rebels to try and figure out everything that belongs there. And Pre Vizsla was a traitor, essentially, with the Death Watch. And yet that name was proudly evoked by Sabine. And we have this character that is a Vizsla as well. I guess Mandalorians don't carry grudges quite that same way, but they're not allowing the sins of the parents and the ancestors to infect the descendants. But yeah, that was an interesting revelation. I wondered if that was something that Jon Favreau was interested in, because he did voice Pre Vizsla back in the Clone Wars.
And why not? I mean, the guy's directing and writing the show, so he might as well. All right, so here's another thing about the Great Purge. So we had kind of speculated that perhaps this was the Jedi Purge, but as you mentioned too, this could be the Siege of Mandalore as well. So have we gotten any confirmation one way or another?
Not a specific confirmation, but I took from the context here, when Pre Vizsla was insulting the Mandalorian and questioning his honor and talking about how since the Purge, they've been hiding like rats, that there was a Mandalorian Purge. And that this is, and I think it was at the same time as the, or thereabouts the same time as the Jedi Purge.
Which makes sense.
Yeah, during, Right, because that Siege of Mandalore was right there at the end of the Clone Wars, right as Order 66 was happening. And frankly, I kind of expect the Empire swept in and took out the Mandalorians as well, because they would have been viewed as a threat, someone who could have organized against the Empire had they wanted to. And we know that there was some of this inner clan struggle happening on Mandalore based on what was going on in Rebels, with certain some of the Mandalorians allying themselves with separatists, but with the Empire, others that were not. Mm-hmm. And, you know, the Empire went to lengths to try and wipe some of them out. So I kind of feel like there was some purge. You know, now that I'm talking it out, reflecting on the fact that there was plenty of Mandalorians around and during the Rebels era, I'm guessing that purge probably happened somewhere during that time period, maybe around New Hope.
Okay.
Now that I'm thinking about it. That was a good question. You got me thinking.
Well, yeah. It's got me thinking too, because, you know, just trying to place all these things in the timeline. And we did get to see these were vibroblades that they were fighting with, correct? I mean, that's the only thing that we really haven't seen vibroblades.
It was so dark. I mean, the Mandalorian has had a knife that he's used a couple times, and that one didn't strike me as a vibroblade, it's just as a knife as well. Okay. But Paz Vizsla, that's hard to say fast.
It is.
his blade could have been. I think there's been a vibroblade somewhere in canon before that got pulled forward from Legends. And why not?
Okay.
It's
a cool weapon.
Well, let's move forward a little bit, because there's some things that we're going to come back to with the Mandalorians here as we get on with the conversation. Let's go back to the cantina when the Mandalorian's talking to Greef Karga. This is one of the things that kind of struck me as a bit of a Western trope, when the Mandalorian is sitting down with Greef Karga. And like I said earlier, and you mentioned in the summary, Greef is just basking in the success that the Mandalorian had bringing in this bounty and the payout that it got, because he says, you know, I'm rich too. And he pulls out those two pieces of Beskar that he's hiding in the inside of his jacket. And I remember thinking at the time, it's like, that's a very interesting place to be keeping your Beskar. And just in classic Western fashion, you know, there'd be a canteen there or someone to hide a really thick Bible there or whatever. And then they'd stop a bullet with that. And then sure enough, at the end of this episode, when Greef corners the Mandalorian on his ship, you know, the Mandalorian, you know, hits the carbonite freezing gas to fill that chamber to provide him some cover, and then turns around and shoots Greef in the chest. It just happens to be where those two pieces of Beskar were.
Yeah, I didn't catch that at first. I thought, oh, really? That's all that his character is going to do in this? I mean, they built him up so big. And then afterwards, I thought, oh, he got him right in the Beskar.
Yeah.
The second time I watched it, then you can actually hear it hit, you know, but the first time I didn't catch that.
When he fell out the back, I was like, well, I've seen him in the trailer for this show in other scenes that he's not appeared in yet. So he has to still be around. And like you said, you could hear that impact there. Greef has got an interesting position. I'm trying to decide what I think about the guy, because on the one hand, it's kind of offensive that he's not bothered by turning over the child to the client. But on the other hand, he does have a code that he is trying to get everyone to honor, because their word is only as good as the code is in the people that they've hired to follow that code.
Right.
And so what did you think about all that, and that his willingness to turn on the Mandalorian and recover that child after the Mandalorian left the Imperial compound with it?
Well, I think a lot of it boils down to whatever's in his best interest and whatever's going to serve his needs the best. Mm-hmm. And I think it was in his best interest to keep the code intact. So whatever, you know, in order for that to happen, he had to somehow try to get the child back, because just with the Mandalorian taking the child, that was obviously breaking the code in a big way. So when one part of the structure breaks down, then he loses control. So I think that, you know, his arrogance and his whole complacency was part of just thinking that the code would never be broken. And so now, and reminding people that you can't do that. You can't do that. That's the rule. You can't do that. But now that it has been broken, he feels directly responsible for trying to get it back.
I'm going to give the infiltration of the Imperial compound short shrift, simply because, well, as cool as it was, and it was amazing to see the Mandalorian do his thing while he was in there, I feel like the more significant parts of the episode occurred elsewhere in this episode. But so the Mandalorian's infiltrated the compound, and then he leaves with the child. And then as he's passing that cantina is when all those fobs start beeping again.
Yeah.
And we've kind of had questions about how those work. And I really do think there is a proximity portion to it. But I'm wondering if those fobs just activated on their own again, because the person that they were tuned to happened to walk by, or if the client and Dr. Pershing turned them back on after the Mandalorian left with it. I guess we don't really have enough information to know one way or the other, but I did find that curious if that was essentially the issuance of a second bounty, or if it was Karga saying, you know what, I took that job on behalf of the guild and then distributed it to bounty hunters that are in the guild. We finished the job, but now someone's reneging on the job, so I got to do something about it. You know, exactly. So again, what you were saying earlier, I've been trying to decide what all this means about his character. You know, he did encourage the Mandalorian to, you know, take a Camtano of spice and use it on his way to his next bounty, and he'd forget about this kid along the way. I'm fascinated by that character, and I guess the larger comment is they've done a great job in this episode creating these complex characters. You know, we had Queel, and now we've got the Mandalorian, we've got all the other Mandalorians, and we've got Greef Karga, and we still are getting some information about the client, Dr. Pershing and stuff, so it's kind of hard to put them in that classification yet just because they haven't had enough screen time.
Right, and you're absolutely right. I think that there's a certain amount of knowledge that we've gotten, but yet not so much that it's completely predictable at this point. And that's part of why I think this series is so successful thus far. So talking a little bit more too about the tracking fobs, I'm imagining that this is probably an implant much like the same ones that were used for slaves, such as in Anakin's case, but obviously that they don't explode under, you know, if you try to take them out. However, it was interesting that perhaps Pershing did not take it out right away. If it was an implant, like once they had the child back in custody, so to speak.
Yeah. And I'm still not certain about that, because if it was an implant, then either they didn't implant it themselves, or they implanted it and elected again not to give the Greef Karga and the Mandalorian and everyone else all the information about this target, because all they could tell them was that the target was 50 years old and where it was last seen. Whereas if they had put an implant in there themselves, well, you put the implant in, you know who you put it in, you should be able to tell the Mandalorian more about it. So this is one of the great things about this series, is that these questions just raise more questions. There's no answers yet right now. And so we still get a lot of things to wonder about that have an opportunity to be fleshed out in future episodes or future seasons, for that matter.
Right. And that's true too of Dr. Pershing. I mean, they were obviously, he and the client were so excited. They were just kept repeating, yes, yes. Oh, it's healthy. Yes, yes. Mm-hmm. And just so pleased with the fact that it had been returned. And for what reason? I mean, obviously, that's one of the questions we need to ask. And Pershing was saying, I'm trying to save him. He would have been dead if it weren't for me. So what are your thoughts on that?
I'm glad you brought that up, because as has become my habit, the second or third time I watch an episode, I put it with the closed captioning on. When the Mandalorian was spying on the Imperial compound and he was kind of getting up that broken transmission with the static, he heard the client talking to Dr. Pershing. The client said, extract the necessary material and be done with it. And then he also said he has explicitly ordered us to bring it back alive.
Wow.
And so there's someone else that has put the client, Werner Herzog's character, and Dr. Pershing in charge of acquiring this asset, the child, and bringing it back alive. The client is feeling some sort of stress or some sort of pressure about that part, and he's resolved just to get whatever material they need. I'm assuming that's midichlorians.
That's what just came to my mind.
Yeah,
too.
The baby, and then getting rid of the kid, because, well, we've seen what's happened, is that there's all these bounty hunters that are going after it, and there may potentially be other bounties. There may be other parties that are interested in this child, and if the child's gotten rid of, well, that's a lot easier to handle just whatever that they've extracted than it is the kid itself.
So if, here's a crazy thought. So if midichlorians can be extracted from someone's blood, does that mean that they can be inoculated with them? Kind of like forced steroids? Is that kind of where,
I know what I mean? You know, I've been thinking about this an awful lot, and I've come up with some way crazy theories that I don't know that I want to get into, because they could, that would triple the length of this episode probably. But as you pointed out back in our review of chapter one, and it's become common knowledge on the internet, Dr. Pershing's got a patch on his sleeve that looks like it's the Kaminoan patch that we saw in Attack of the Clones, that a lot of the clones wore as well. So we know, unless this is a red herring, that there's some sort of cloning aspect to all of this going on. So you get the material you need out of this baby and you're going to dispose of the baby. Well, then what? You're going to make another one? You're going to make a clone? Is this a clone? Are you going to clone a clone? Or are you trying to use the midichlorians in a different clone of some kind? If that's the case, what is the ultimate goal? And we don't really have an answer to that. I could make some crazy guesses, but we need to wrap this up here in the next 10 minutes or so.
Well, one other thought too, as far as Dr. Pershing is concerned, I mean, obviously he's human.
Right.
So if he is working for the Kaminoans, such as like Lamassu, who knows what their life expectancy is, but someone along that lines, the prime minister of Kamino at the time, is he just a paid scientist? Is he, you know, I mean, these are all things that I know we all want to know.
Right.
If he, in fact, is working for the Kaminoans.
I think he was a Kaminoan agent and they're working for somebody else.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not
that
exactly
sense.
Certain who that is, but...
Mm-hmm.
But so let's talk about the climactic confrontation of the episode where the Mandalorian is making his way through the streets back to his ship with the child in tow. And then he gets surrounded by Greef Karga and all the bounty hunters. And he holds his own for a little bit and is about to make a getaway on the speeder before Greef shoots the droid that's piloting the speeder, which, you know, hey, we know the Mandalorian doesn't particularly care for droids. He wouldn't get on a droid pilot speeder earlier in the series,
right.
But here he was doing this. And when all appears lost, the Mandalorians make their dramatic entrance. That was just incredible.
Man.
I geeked out so hard when that happened.
I'm telling you what, it's one thing to see it in an animated series like the Clone Wars or even Rebels, you know, with jetpacks and that type of thing. But it is on a whole other level entirely to see it live action. I mean, that was just like chills going up and down my spine and just my jaw dropped open. And I was just like, wow. Yeah. Like the best birthday, Christmas present, Easter basket ever.
Yeah. And so they got, you know, they came in on the jetpacks. The, you know, Paz Vizsla was the heavy Mandalorian with that cannon there that he was blasting everyone away with. And he makes his getaway. And then as he's flying away in the Razor Crest, I couldn't tell if that was Paz or a different one, but they come flying up by him in his ship with their rocket pack. And the Mandalorian says, I got to get one of those. So,
yes.
Yeah, you do. It's pretty awesome.
Oh, man.
So I want to ask you a question here.
Yeah.
This episode was called The Sin. What was The Sin? Because I can think of three possibilities, but I'm curious to see what you think The Sin was.
Ah, okay. So the first thing that came to my mind after, of course, watching this was that he went against the guild. And I hadn't really thought anything further than that. So that was probably, you know, because he committed a sin against the guild and he went against a code.
Right. Okay. That was one of the things I was thinking. The other thing I considered was turning over a defenseless child to the Empire. That is a sin in itself. And it's one that he attempted to rectify in this episode. And then the other potential sin was the sitting down with the Imperials, which were the enemy of the Empire. They were the ones that, so it was a way kind of a betrayal. And that one was forgiven. And the Mandalorians came back to his aid. And so, like I said, I think there's three potential answers to this, but the episode's called The Sin. So there's one that they had in mind for this. And I'm inclined to agree with you that it is the betrayal of the guild and not following that rule, that he's essentially putting aside the source of his success and the source of his livelihood, which is doing, collecting bounties on behalf of this guild in order to protect this child.
Okay. Yeah. I like all three of those theories actually, because they do make sense. And I think that might be the whole purpose of the title of the episode is maybe to allow the viewer to interpret it in whatever way they choose.
Yeah. My wife, Beth, who's my co-host on Warp Trails, had an interesting point when we were talking about this the other night. She said it kind of reminded her of the notion that in Guardians of the Galaxy Volume 2, Yondo was an outcast from the Ravagers for trafficking in children and bringing them into this. And so these bounty hunters don't have that rule. Doesn't seem like anyone particularly liked it, but they, and so you had Greef saying, well, you know, go take a Kamtano spice and you'll forgotten all about it.
Yeah.
But that was something that was going to, you know, that rankled the Mandalorian's own conscience. And, you know, it was the Empire was the one encouraging that sin in that case. But so anyways, that was just something I've been thinking about because I really feel like it was an ambiguous title, like you suggested, for that reason, to get you to think.
And I do think it was purposely done, but that's, I mean, that totally makes sense too. And speaking of Yondu, we kind of glazed over the whole whistling birds thing. Yes. So that was kind of like an Iron Man Yondu sort of crossover, which
well,
of course
it is
you
a John Favreau project.
Exactly.
So.
but of course you knew when they were crafting everything from the Beskar and she said, well, we'll make whistling birds out of this. And he said, whistling birds will do fine. And of course, you know, that's a little foreshadowing in terms of you have to use these very sparingly, but they can be a powerful weapon against multiple enemies. So I knew as soon as we got to that scene with all of those stormtroopers, I knew that he was going to end up using those. But yeah, it was kind of like Yondu's little whistle thing.
Right.
And the Iron Man gauntlet kind of all in one.
Yeah.
Which was still super cool. I'm not discounting it by saying that at all. And then another Iron Man moment was at the very end when he says, you know, about the jetpack, I got to get me one of those. That was kind of an Iron Man moment there as well. So I'm assuming that we said that was Paz, we think, Vizsla at the end there.
That's who I took it to be.
Who I took it to be as well. So, you know, when it comes down to it, Mando a mano, you know, they really do take care of themselves.
Let's finish up our discussion then with, we haven't really given the child any attention during this episode.
Really.
And, you know, the thing is, as cute as he is, he wasn't an active part of the story so much. He was more of a passive role in this. He had the adorable moment at the beginning of the episode where he climbs out of the bassinet and he climbs up onto the control panel and takes off the knob from the that lever that seems to have a bunch of uses. It powers up the ship and, you know, controls the engines or whatever. And, you know, the Mandalorian took it away from him. And then when they're making their getaway, the kid gets up there again and the Mandalorian unscrews it and drops that little knob in his hands for him to play with. Yes. So
that was so endearing. I love that.
Yeah. And then he had the kind of the look of alarm when Dr. Pershing was taking him into the other room when the Mandalorian had delivered him. But, you know, it was, I actually liked the way they handled the child in this episode, because while he was present and he was observing, he wasn't as active a part as he was in the second episode, which was called The Child.
Right.
And so you really got to have him around for us all to be, you know, to coo at and be excited about. But then we got to focus on the Mandalorian and the decisions that he was making in this episode.
Right. Yeah, I think the first two episodes definitely established the importance of the child. Mm-hmm. And like you said, got us all to ooh and ah and very much bring the fandom together. I mean, I think this is probably, and I've said this before, one of the only things that all Star Wars fans can pretty much agree on is that Baby Yoda is amazing. Yep. But yeah, there were definitely some endearing moments. And all I could think of to myself was how fun Pedro Pascal must have had just picking up that little bundle of Yoda and gently putting him back into his little bassinet after he grabbed that little control knob for the first time.
Yeah.
I just thought that was adorable. And you know, going back to with the whole not taking the helmet thing off and this is the way, I actually ran into a student of mine earlier tonight on my way home. I stopped into one of the stores where this kid was working and he said, "Are you watching The Mandalorian?" I said, "You bet I am." And he said, "Did you see the third chapter yet?" And I said, "I sure did." He said, "I'm so ready to see his face. I want him to take off his helmet." I'm like, "You might have to wait for that for a little while. This is the way." And he goes, "This is the way." So, you know, that whole line now, you know, we've got is I have spoken and this is the way. So the Mandalorian has given us a lot of these nice little lines here, but some really good throwbacks too with, you know, again, like we said, with the kind of old feelings from the original trilogy and just some of the really classic kinds of things being thrown in there too.
Definitely. All right. Well, we're about out of time. So why don't we go ahead and finish this off with our final thoughts and our grades?
Well, by far, I think this has been I wouldn't say the most enjoyable episode, but yet again, it was. It was, now that we've gotten past these first two episodes, like I said, where we've established some of the beginnings and some of the lore and some of the reasons why things are happening the way that they are, now we can jump all the way in with all this great action. And still leave us thirsting for more answers. And I loved the callbacks to things like Dr. Ball, you know, the torture droid that we got to see, and, you know, all of the Camtano. I mean, that was great. And the whole idea of the Mandalorian culture and of course seeing Jon Favreau, and just again the connection that the Mandalorian has with the child. That is, I think, something that all of us, no matter whether we're Star Wars fans or just human beings, I think that is one of the reasons why this series is being so connected to all of us, is because we can all empathize with some of these things, yet enjoy all of these action sequences and everything that makes it Star Wars as well. So I just think that it was a very well written, very well executed episode, by far my favorite one of the three so far. And maybe I'm being a little biased with the Mandalorian stuff, but you know, it's all good. So definitely an A plus for me.
Yeah, it's an A episode. You know, it's difficult to grade these because they're all been exceptional. And so, you know, it's the, if I had to, I'm having a hard time grading them against each other because they've all been at a very, very high bar. This one was, again, directed by Deborah Chow. So this is the first time a woman got to direct a Star Wars project. So
yes, which we glazed right over. So that's right. Pretty amazing.
Right. And she's going to be directing Kenobi. So we've got that coming up from her as well. So I'm very excited about that, that, you know, that series is in good hands. This was, I think, amongst the three episodes, probably the best paced and had the best use of the camera to tell the story here. And so she did a phenomenal job with that, and it was a really great episode. I like that all three of these episodes have been a different type of a story. As I mentioned when we discussed Chapter 2, it was kind of the Odyssey story, in that, you know, the Mandalorian's trying to get home now that he's made this voyage and he has a detour. And now he gets home and he has to make a choice about whether he's going to honor the job he took or he's going to follow his conscience, which he ends up doing. You know, the first one was very much a getting to know the characters and establishing this galaxy, and Dave Filoni was perfect for that. And so we've had three different types of episodes. They've all been fantastic, but, and they've all done their job very, very, very well. So yeah, it's definitely an A for me. And I'm really, really excited to see where they go next with this. Well, then that will do it for our review of The Sin, which is episode 3 of The Mandalorian. I'd just like to remind everyone that you can find all episodes of Podcast Stardust on RetroZap, Apple Podcasts, Stitcher, Overcast, or wherever it is that you listen to your podcasts. We are a part of the RetroZap Podcast Network. You can subscribe to the network feed and get all of the great RetroZap shows in one convenient place. We'd also really appreciate it if you could leave us an iTunes review. You've all been coming through on that for us. We just had a review from AF Chris 77 today, and so that was a welcome site when I checked on the podcast feed today. So thank you very much. Those 5-star reviews with a comment really go a long way in helping the show get noticed by people that are looking for new Star Wars shows. And then they land on our page and they see that people have positive things to say about it that might push them over the edge of giving us a shot. And we really do appreciate that. And again, thanks to everyone that's been getting the word of mouth out there, whether you're telling your friends, you're posting the show on social media, Facebook, wherever it is that you've been finding it, that's been a fantastic help and can't thank you enough. Jay, once again, where are our social media contacts around the internet?
We can be found on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram at Podcast Stardust. And if you want to connect with Dennis on Twitter, he is at DJKVER2, and I am at Joyce Krebs. You can also check out our Pinterest page. We have tons of boards over there. We are also on YouTube, where you can find all of our episodes as well as our unboxing videos for various products, both current and future. You can email us at podcaststardust@retrozap.com. We will read your emails on air for you and for everyone else to hear as well. So if you have any thoughts on this episode or any of the episodes of The Mandalorian or just anything in general Star Wars related, we'd love to hear your thoughts. Also, check us out over on Discord. We have our Discord channel there on the RetroZap server. And so we'll be there talking about everything Star Wars, basically. Mandalorian, Last Jedi to The New Hope, and Clone Wars and Rebels, and everything in between. And you can also check out our store at TeePublic. We have several designs over there, thanks to Corey Club for those designs. And you can get everything for anything in your house, and as well as people on your list for the holidays. So go check that out.
All right. Well, that'll do it then for episode 24 of Podcast Stardust. Thanks for listening, everyone. Until next time, may the Force be with you. This is the way.